Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us on this meetup about updating costly and heavy core systems. My name is João Abreu. I'm QuidJest Press Officer and Content Manager. With me, I have the pleasure to have Carlos Nogueira, QuidJest Customer Success Manager. Throughout this presentation, we will explain to you how to evaluate if your system is obsolete, explore the problems businesses can face when they're using inappropriate outdated technology, talk about the obstacles associated with new system implementations, and showcase how this can bring companies out of business. And because there are no problems without solutions, we will then share QuidJest methodology to solve the legacy systems problem. Finally, we will briefly explain how you and your company can benefit from QuidJest Academy, and we'll also have time for a 10 to 15 minute Q&A. Please feel free to leave your questions on the chat throughout the presentation. Let me just start this off by quickly presenting you QuidJest. For those who are not aware, we're an international IT company based in Lisbon, Portugal, that's been working with artificial intelligence for more than 30 years now. We've been pioneers in using AI to automate software production. Our teams have actually been doing it since the 80s. QuidJest created its very own artificial intelligence-driven tool called Genio, which is also one of the main reasons why we stand out in the market. It enables us to deliver software 100 times faster than the average IT company, and this applies to a variety of digital strategies, such as a subject that brought you all here today, the update of obsolete platforms. We've extended operations to more than 200 organizations worldwide, as you can see on this slide. And in every single project we develop, we guarantee it's the solution that fits the needs of the client and not the opposite. It's also important to note that we're extremely focused on continuous improvements and on making sure our clients are able to quickly adapt their digital strategies whenever needed. Okay, now that we've introduced QuidJest, let me start off by assessing if your core system is obsolete or reaching a near obsolescence threshold. We developed a form to help you out with this, which will be available on the bottom right of the screen during the presentation. If you want to assess it now, use your smartphone camera to scan the QR code. After you submit the form, one of our specialists will reach you out via email with an evaluation of your system. However, if you want to start an evaluation procedure on your own, there's also a simple way of assessing if a core system is obsolete. Right, Carlos?
Yes, there are several factors that can reveal if a software is obsolete or not. Flexibility is one of them, and user experience is another one.
What do you mean by flexible? What are the criteria to define if a system is flexible or not?
There are many things, but let's say that we can see the flexibility as if it's future-proof. Firstly, when the evolution of the systems to provide the new functionality that is required by the organization is virtually impossible, and the last update or feature was introduced a long time ago, you know that's not flexible either. Then there is the readiness of the system to adapt to external demands, for instance, new regulations. When the organization cannot implement these changes on the system in the given time, it's not flexible. Also, there's the question of availability. When the system only allows a specific interface and it's not easy to access at all times, at any place or device, it's not flexible also. For the last, if it relies on the certain hardware to operate, then it's not flexible either and not future-proof.
You also mentioned bad user experience. How can one measure a company's UX?
Well, that point is somewhat subjective, but there are several indicators that can tell if the clients don't have what they need in the system. For instance, if they need an intensive training to use it, if they need to memorize codes to fill out the forms, if they need to navigate through several menus, fill several forms to do one simple task, that it isn't available right away, or through wizard or assistance, that's not user-friendly. If they need to read the manual to know what to do next, that's not intuitive, and it's bad for the users since they are wasting time for their work learning the system, while it could be more friendly and straightforward. One other point that I can say in this subject is the lack of feedback. If the system doesn't support feedback for common questions or to suggest improvements, it's a static front end and will not be updated accordingly on for future versions. It's assuming that nothing has to change and users are always happy. That's a bad principle. The feedback of user experience can also be done in other ways, using analytics on the system to know how much time the users take to do one simple task and how can it be improved. Also can do some user experience inquiries and also analyzing the complaints that are reached through email or a ticketing system. All in all, if the focus isn't in the users, then it's a problem by itself.
Okay, thank you for that, Carlos. Let me just reinforce that everyone watching us can write down their questions in the chat, and we will answer them when we're done with the presentation. Moving on, there are obvious difficulties associated with legacy system. Carlos, besides the lack of flexibility and the bad UX, what problems can companies operating with legacy systems expect?
The software evolution is one of the most challenging issues in today's business environment. Organizations must align their business process to compete with the global businesses and to satisfy their customers. The existing large software, namely the legacy systems, have never been built to cope with the current business requirements and its natural evolution. Moreover, they usually lack up-to-date documentation. They require skilled manpower or on the outdated frameworks or on the code languages, usually have high licenses costs. Systems are often slow due to the poor logic, bad design structures, and its obsolete hardware, which they are tied to. They lack interfaces and also lack integration services that lead to a greater difficulty when they need to integrate to their systems. This all adds up to outcomes. Maintenance of the legacy system software is costly because the fault detection is expensive and time consuming due to proper documentation and the lack of knowledge about the functionalities in the system. So these kind of systems are almost of the time in the halt state. Then the evolution of the legacy systems to provide new functionality required by the organization is virtually impossible.
Okay, Carlos, could you please extend the explanation about the evolution problem?
Sure. The application leaders face conflicting challenges as they try to evolve their application platform strategies. First and foremost, they must support the established system of record application portfolio at the lowest possible cost and look for stable, low risks products that are focused primarily on reducing the total cost of ownership. At the same time, they must also provide the platforms that enable rapid innovation for digital business initiatives. Modern applications require new technologies and architectures such as a cloud, mobile, in-memory computing, web scale, microservices, and so on. and standardizing on a single application is virtually impossible. Traditional platforms don't support all this on cloud native application, and also won't run on these platforms. An organization often needs multiple platforms, but an unstructured application platform selection process can lead to a proliferation of redundant and conflicting platforms, which can in turn lead to an unmanaged costs and risks.
Okay, so this obviously poses a problem to organizations. Could you please go deeper into the new platform's reality of AI and cloud?
Yes. I'd say the organizations supporting legacy software suites will find adopting AI very challenging because this generally require to upgrade or replace their suites in order to access these new features. Whichever generation of software suite is used in-house, an organization's readiness will depend on it having enterprise planners with advanced and diverse skills, both to identify where AI and cloud will be most beneficial to create and monitor these models. Enterprises will also have to overcome the aversion to risk and approach it experimentally with careful planning.
Okay, Carlos, could you please sum this up? What are the main differences in the business models of the companies using legacy systems and the ones who are operating with modern technology?
Well, I think it's clear that new era business outpace the legacy ones at a greater scale and speed, resulting in lower costs, faster delivery, and greater technology usage. The traditional risk assessment approaches are too slow, too siloed, and unscalable to accommodate the digital business deliverables.
Okay, so with all this in mind and considering the problems you just mentioned, why are companies stuck with costly systems that are dragging them behind their competition?
That's a good question. I think there's one thing that can be behind without even knowing it. And that's the problem by itself. This is the worst case scenario, and it means when they least expect dramatic changes to their business can happen. Some organizations also stated that the software providers don't communicate with them their product roadmap effectively or clearly. So this means that they lack awareness of upcoming deprecations, and this leaves them with obsolete solutions without knowledge. Then there are also the situations where they suspect or already know that they are lagging behind and are faced with the decision to react to the new situation. And then there's two possible ways out. There are cases when they decide to react, but can't do it properly for many causes and spare too much money and resources on it, trying to fight against the wave. And there are cases when they decide that's not to react because they choose to do so. I'd say there are two main fears that lead to that and are part of the human nature. One is the fear of the unknown, and the other, the resistance to change.
Okay, yeah, such fears are naturally a barrier to the implementation of a modern system. And we can see that actually in the banking industry, for example, we see a lot of new players such as Revolut, 1026, and Nubank coming in and attracting clients who seek better customer experience and support and seamless control over their assets. Carlos, what are the main differences between the banks that are operating over an updated core system and the ones operating over a legacy system?
Well, mainly the new players use the technology upper hand. let's say that. This allows them to offer new services all around with greater user experience and operation speeds and so on. And that is also a sweet deal to attract new customers and can grow their market share by offering better quality, faster response and better customer success. The laggers will have to struggle to keep their operating systems and will continuously lacking behind if nothing else is done, and will eventually try to keep up with their old weapons. But let me say that even the new player strategy is doomed if they don't follow a continuous innovation alongside with the new technologies. By this, I mean that you can see that old banks once were using the state-of-the-art technology at a certain period, and new players now in the field will face the same destiny if they follow the same strategy. Continuous innovation is the key here.
And talking about continuous innovation, Netflix and Blockbuster are great examples of the extreme sides of the spectrum. On the one hand, you have Netflix, the business that invested in updating operation and pivoting their strategy. And on the other hand, we have Blockbuster, a company that decided to stick with the same old technology and did not change. Carlos, what can we learn from this real world business case?
It's an interesting one. In this particular case, I think that it's clear that if Blockbuster would have put their strengths on the streaming market, they nowadays would be one of the biggest players and still holding a great part of his market share. I think they didn't anticipate this move and didn't react accordingly. CIOs and application leaders must act to ensure that the IT is not sidelined when developing or deploying a base layer strategy. This should provide solutions to a wide range of business needs, thereby raising the relevance of the IT organization as an enabler of the business strategy. Blockbuster failed miserably at this. They wanted to keep their old businesses where the customers were crying for a change.
Yeah, they were definitely crying for a change. Okay, so how can we guarantee your businesses will not follow Blockbuster's path? Carlos, are you care to explain?
Okay, let me see. Companies usually have two options on the table. They either change the business to fit the way the system works, or replace the legacy system to fit the way the business work. In this case, Blockbuster followed the wrong path. There's a third one that is the evolution choice, but is never really left on the table because even a small or custom change that is required in legacy systems usually involve high costs and therefore is rejected. This is the primary cause that stops any evolution attempt.
Okay, so what's QuidJest's vision to this problem? You talked about the third option on the table that includes evolution. Do we approach it?
Yes. QuidJest's principles and vision are based on the software engineering that uses a model-driven approach and uses patterns instead of coding. This grants us technology independence using GNU. We use this approach internally and transfer it to all of our solutions. There are usually two cases when upgrading from legacy systems. We either have a solution on our portfolio or we don't. In any case, the client data is preserved on the upgraded solution. Both of them will have the same benefits since we provide a state-of-the-art solution that will grant evolution at a fast pace.
Okay, so we were just talking about fears and obstacles that prevent companies from moving forward and upgrading their operations with a new core system. What's our approach to mitigate these fears?
Well, we can take the example for the data loss. In this case, we have listed all the important data that is needed for the new system to operate, and us with a close collaboration with our clients, we transfer all the data from the old system to the new solution. On the second case, where we don't have the solution in hand, we analyze the client's data and infer it in GNU model. Using reverse engineering, all data is swiftly copied from the old database for no new one. This means that the data loss concern is taken care of because it's impossible by the nature of each process. Then you can fear that it's too expensive. QuickJazz has perhaps the most competitive solutions for a fraction of the competition prices on every stage of the process. I can name a few, but there are not only these ones. We charge no bills or annual licenses by the name or number of users, the volume of the data, or even by the number of functionalities used. Another fear that is common is the lack of flexibility on the new system. With GNU, that grants a new way of software development on this approach. Development with GNU offers several advantages, with a great impact on reducing the work made that it's handwritten by humans. You can understand the needs and the design, the solution with the client, and you create the business model in GNU. If there is an existent to be replaced application, you have a set of tools to understand and to replicate the old solution in the new one. The testing does not exist as a separate stage, as they are embedded as a poke-yoke in the entire development process. GNU does the integration automatically and also generates on average 98% of the code of the final solution. This means that with 10 times less people in the team and with the 10 times shorter projects, the project management also becomes more straightforward.
Okay, so it's more than fair to say then that our methodology enables a digital strategic agility through smaller investments, right?
Yes, indeed. Nowadays, almost all IT budgets are being captured by the operation and maintenance costs. You know this as OPEX, of old and obsolete information systems. This prevents the investment in innovation, the CAPEX, and removes the competitiveness, the efficiency, and agility from the organizations. Through our methodology, with a small CAPEX investment, obsolete management software is converted into new solutions which are already equipped with the latest technologies. They are also more efficient.
Carlos, pardon me, let me just interrupt you there. What are the costs of maintaining a new platform? And how does it affect the mindset of the teams?
We have some measurements, and our operation and maintenance costs are up to 10 times more economical than the competition. QuickJazz also grants the replacement of the obsolete platforms with expensive maintenance and dependent on a single person, or they are difficult to evolve. This transition takes place using the stored data and improving the functionality of the old system. In practice, we migrate technologically obsolete solutions, recreating them with all the features in the most modern technology, the architectures, programming language, and the development methodologies that's proven to be more efficient. In the old days, the teams work independently and focused almost exclusively in the way the solutions were produced. Now, this concept has changed and the focus must be on the way the solutions are used. There's a good quote from Gartner that states that focus on the application of technology and not on the application technology. This is the mindset that must prevail for organizations to achieve a greater success, to understand where and how the IT generates value, building and learning together with the business.
Okay, thank you for the explanation, Carlos. With this said, I understand that it can be quite hard to retain all that information. So let's share a practical use case of a project already developed by us. For instance, let's take a look at what we did in a project with the government of Jamaica. Before I click play on this, let me just say that the following video was not produced by us. It was produced by Jamaica's government.
Connectivity in the public sector is happening now, and it's here to stay. By now, we're used to clicking, swiping, pinning, and posting when it comes to our social browsing, shopping, and more. Now, connectivity in the public sector puts HR processes right at our fingertips, anytime, anywhere. Introducing MyHR Plus. It is an integrated HR and payroll system that will serve everyone working in the public sector. This new, easy-to-use IT system boasts significant benefits, not just for the public administration, but also for you, the employee. Imagine being able to apply for vacation leave at midnight, or filing a claim from your smartphone while waiting at the salon. Through MyHR Plus, regular HR processes are accessible from any computer, phone, or tablet. Just activate your account and log in using your username and password. MyHR Plus is ready to use. Once you've logged in, you can see our website is a breeze. It will guide you through the system, ensuring that all tasks will be completed easily and quickly. MyHR Plus provides managers with information to effectively and efficiently manage staff. Now, HR will have reliable data for strategic decision making.
This human resource management system with integrated payroll was definitely needed by PICA. So what MyHR Plus enables us to do is to meet the needs of our clients in an efficient and timely manner and free us up to do more strategic work.
With customs going live, the persons there are more appreciative of the system because they can stay at their desk or anywhere in the world and print their payslips.
Our extremely secure platform guarantees that your information is protected with the safest, most advanced technology. Plus, it's available from anywhere, anytime. For more information, call us at 876-932-5534 or email myhrplus-support@mof.gov.jm.
But let's just talk about this, right? So Carlos, we developed this project in about six months, right? Jamaica's government.
Yes, that's this first phase that enabled the project to go live was around that time, yes. It was built from scratch, and it's also important to share with you that now it's being used by more than 100,000 people.
Okay, it's impressive how a team of less than 20 people was able to pull this off in about 6 months. Let me just remind our audience that you are free to use the chat to ask us any questions. And now, as I said in the beginning, we've created our very own artificial intelligence driven tool that helps us stand out in the market. It's called Geniu, and it's an extremely low code platform. It automatically translates models into code, which in turn makes it possible to produce 160 million lines of code per day. With one tenth of the human resources, you will be able to develop 10 times faster than the average IT company. We are truly enthusiastic about empowering individuals and organizations with Geniu. As you can see, our academy has 6 programs designed for specific audiences, from the G developer program to the G executive. So for instance, by enrolling with us on a project to update your legacy system, we can train your people so that they can independently introduce their own modules on the platform, which will make you substantially faster than your average competitor who's stuck to a most likely slow IT team. We understand that this may seem too good to be true, but let me share my personal experience. I have a background in journalism. That's what I studied, and except for a couple of very amateur programming experiences, I never had to develop software. I enrolled in the G developer program, and with just 3 days of training, where I learned the concepts and did some practical exercises, I was able to develop from scratch my own content management platform in around 10 hours of work. The solution I created has 74 function points, which would take an average amount of 4.5 months for a manual code developer, as you can see on the chart on the right of this slide. If you would like to know more about our academy or understand why program suits you best, you can either scan the QR code on the screen or access our website via the bit.ly link. Okay, so now moving on to our Q&A, let me just check if there are any questions.
If you have any questions about anything, please do.
Carlos, can you see any questions in the chat?
Yes. Due to our day's fast businesses changes, most of software management solutions become obsolete the day they start operating. How do you manage this issue with QuickJest solutions? The same problem with fast changing infrastructure technology. Are QuickJest solutions attached or addicted to a specific technology? There are several questions here. So, the first part, how do we manage this issue on QuickJest solution? The fast businesses changes become obsolete the day they start operating. So QuickJest has an approach that is evolutionary and agile with the client. We have multiple stages that integrate certain features that are delivered and available and ready to operate. So this is the way QuickJest starts implementing our projects or solutions, not developing the whole thing and then deploying. That reality most likely had changed from the beginning of the project to the day that we delivered this solution. So we don't have this problem. Our software isn't obsolete in this process. The other question in it is the fastings changing infrastructure technology, and if QuickJest solution are attached or addicted to a specific technology. No. We have a software house that is based on the model-driven engineering model, and by this I can say that we are not attached to any kind of technology, any kind of languaging, any kind of structure. Because when you have the model, you can then generate the final solution in any given language that it's required. So we have the model. Let's say I have a model of a chair which has a seat and four legs, and that's how we model the world and the solutions by capturing the nature of itself. Then we can create the reality, that's the code generation, to any given languages. Let's say you want the chair to be built in plastic. The same process is made here. You can build it on wood or metal or something else. And the same process on QuickJest is made through this way. We have the model that can be generated to any given language.
Okay, I believe that's about it for that question in specific. We have an anonymous user asking us if I have an old application developed in an old database, such as COBOL, Clipper, etc. How fast and easy can you migrate it completely to your methodology and technology?
Okay, so there are several cases that we started from an old database and inferred using reverse engineering the inner model in the database, and in start we could copy the old database that was running with COBOL or Clipper into the new ones like SQL or SQL or Oracle, and then with the data kept preserved, we checked which were the features that were in the old platform and transferred to the new one using models and the patterns that are available in Genio to completely migrate an old system to a new system.
Okay, thank you, Carlos. We have another question from Ronaldo Gurgel. I hope I spelled that right. He asks us, how do you respond to migration from legacy system that uses databases with lots of inconsistencies? Do you want me to repeat that? No.
I understood. So, okay. That is common to happen. Old databases suffer a lot of this problem, where the model isn't perfect, and we deal and cope with that the inconsistency. Firstly, we have to check which model is being done on the old database. Okay, and then using the new generation Genio platform, we can see and with models to do that, we can check which inconsistencies are in the model. Okay, so redundancy, let's say that there are loops on the database or something else, Genio detects and helps to create a better model to work with the new system, but was initially based on the old one.
All right, we do have a question from Philippe, which is, the question is pretty short actually, which is, he asks us, what are the steps
What are the steps to change?
Exactly.
I don't know if I answer correctly, but I'll try to make up for this question. So, let's say the question is about what's needed to change from an old core system to a new one using QGIS or another methodology or another company. Well, the first thing to know is what's the main things that you want to upgrade. Okay, what's being kept you behind? What applications need to, an immediate change? Okay, then you ask for assistance if you don't have an IT qualified for it to understand what's wrong, what's really obsolete and need to be upgraded. With QGIS, we have several ways to do better. We have the partnership, we have the academy, as João said, for guys that are into technology and are IT members that have the knowledge and want to make ownership of the new platform. That's also possible using our partnership and our QGIS Academy. We can do it on our own. We have the qualified personnel for that. Just reach us and we'll let you know which is the better option for you.
Okay, so I do have a question. I believe we don't have any other questions from the audience. No, but I do have a question. When we were sharing the examples of banks, you said all banks were using state-of-the-art technology during a certain period of time, and they would never reach an obsolescence threshold if they were using our technology. My question is, does Quidgest actually keep on updating all of its solutions, or does it just update the most important ones?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question, and goes in line with the first one that I answered. We have a technology independence, but we need it to work, right? So we have our own development team, our own research and development. We have a roadmap. We are constantly in contact with our providers. We check their roadmaps and see how is going to be the next change, where is going to happen, what's becoming deprecated, and soon we know this information and we start moving. Sometimes on the reactive mode, but we need to do the changes. And sometimes we are ahead of the game, starting to do our own research and using latest technology by our own initiative.
Very well. I do believe that's it. If you have any questions but would rather see them answered privately, you can also write us an email and we'll reach you out as soon as possible. You can see our emails over here. Well, let's just leave us with a thank you very much for following our presentation. Feel free to contact us, and I hope you enjoyed it.